from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Just then a lawyer stood up and tried to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he too passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The lawyer said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of the Lord. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to you all as we gather here for this special session, and a particularly warm welcome to those of you who are coming to celebrate the anointing of the sick. A warm welcome to anyone who might be listening on the radio and to anyone who might be following on YouTube. You probably heard the news this morning in Dublin of a terrible tragedy of a fire in a house in South Dublin, and it seems, at least the media reporting, that up to 8 people at least have died in this tragedy, one of them a little child. So let us pray for all who are caught up, pray for the dead that they may have eternal rest, for the injured that they may be healed, and of course for the bereaved that they may be comforted. Please keep them in your prayers this day. Later on this afternoon, we're going to celebrate another session with the Sacrament of the Sick, and that will be at 2:30, so please do tell others about that. Now, tomorrow, Sunday, the times of the Novena are different to the times that we have been following up to this. So the times tomorrow are, and you get a little leaflet if you don't have one already, with these times on them. So tomorrow morning, the times are 7 a.m., 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11:30 a.m. So they're the morning sessions, 7, 8, 9:30, and 11. The afternoon sessions are 12:30 p.m., 2:30 p.m., and 4:30 p.m. So afternoon, 12:30, 2:30, and 4:30. And the evening sessions are 6 p.m., 7:30 p.m., and finally 9 p.m. The 9 p.m. session will be in candlelight, so 6 p.m., 7:30 p.m., and 9 p.m. There is no 10:30 p.m. session on Sunday. So the last session tomorrow is at 9 o'clock. Tomorrow afternoon at 2:30, we won't have Mass, but we will have the blessing of babies. And Michael Cusack will go into high gear for that, as he does every year. So every child will be blessed and receive a medal, and Michael assures me that there will be some special guests attending for our children. So please bring the kids along tomorrow. And the collection that's been taken up at that 2:30 session tomorrow afternoon is for the Maria Goretti Foundation in Lordship, which provides respite care and support for children in challenging situations. That's the blessing of babies and children tomorrow at 2:30 p.m. without Mass. I remember it as if it were yesterday, but it was a long time ago. It was was Christmas 1989, and I was at the end of 4 years of scripture study in Rome. I was preparing to come home for the Christmas holidays. I had one exam to do in the new year, but I was coming home for Christmas. I went out to the airport, I checked in, I went through security, I went through passport control, and then I wandered around to try and find a seat to sit down. But the place was absolutely thronged. So I searched, and I searched, and I searched, and finally I found a seat and I sat down. Directly opposite me, there was a seat reserved. It was reserved by somebody placing a pair of white Nike trainers on the seat. Now, I can be a bit of an old grump, so in my mind, I went into grump mode, and I was saying, that's really not very fair. There are so many people looking for seats, and here is somebody who just reserved the seat by placing these trainers on it and gone off. And holding the seat for himself or herself. Well, eventually the owner of the seat and the trainers turned up. He was about 25 years old. He was wearing a long black priest's cassock with scarlet silk lining, in a big white high collar under his chin. He sat down, took off the trainers off the seat, sat down, opened up his prayer book, and began to say his prayers. And I went into really grumpy mode, and I fumed to myself, and I said, my God, they're ordaining babies now, because this lad looked like he hadn't even learned to shave. Anyway, I was called for my flight. I headed home, had a wonderful Christmas, and I forgot about the baby in the cassock. Well, I got back to Rome in January of 1990, and I was facing my final exam. It was being done by an interview. Now, the lecturer we had was a very severe man, and he gave us all a date and a time to come and to be interviewed by a panel. This was the final exam. And he warned us that if we were late, or if we turned up on the wrong date or at the wrong time, we would fail the exam, and we'd have to spend another year in Rome to take another subject to do a final exam in that. And I had no intentions of doing that. I wanted to get home altogether. But on the morning of the exam, and this was the day in January, it was a very cold, frosty morning. And I was walking along the roadway, along the pavement, heading to where I was going to do this exam. And I saw a commotion ahead of me. People were, they were stepping over something, or they were stepping around something. As I got closer, I realized that it wasn't a something that was on the pavement. It was a someone. A young, black, North African, probably from Tunisia, who had come to Italy to find a fortune, but only found poverty and racism. He was lying cold, out cold, on the pavement. As I got near to him, my conscience started to tell me I really should do something to help this man. I even thought about the story that Jesus tells in today's gospel, the story of the Good Samaritan. But I had my excuses, especially my final exam. So I, too, passed by. I'd just gone a few meters down the road. When who did I meet coming in the opposite direction but the baby in the cassock? I looked back to see, is that the guy I saw at the airport? And it surely was. And he went by me, big high collar and all of that, with a big smile on his face. He went straight over to where this young man was lying cold on the street, and he gently woke him up. We all stood and watched. He sat him up against the wall, started to chat with him, reached in under his cassock, produced a pack of cigarettes, offered a cigarette to the young man, took a cigarette himself, lit them up, and chatted away while I and the Roman crowd gawked. I hurried off to do my exam. I got there in time, and I did my exam. Do you know what grade I got in my final exam? I got 100%. 100%. I was now a qualified biblical scholar. I could head home and start to teach the scriptures. But for all my qualifications and training, I had passed that young African man by. I had scorned that young priest, and I had failed to see the Good Samaritan. lying cold on a Roman street. Today's parable is probably one of the best known and the best loved of all Jesus' stories. A man is beaten up, robbed, left there on the side of the road, half dead. A Jewish priest comes along and he passes by. He's not a bad man. He's not a bad man. He's a good man, following the rules. The next character, a Jewish Levite, he does the same. He thinks, well, my boss has passed by, done nothing, why should I do anything? And he passes by too. And the last character is a Samaritan, hated by the Jews, considered to be dirty, unclean people. And even though he knows that if he helps this man to change nothing, he'd still be considered a dirty, unclean person. He does what the other two were not willing to do. And of course, he's the hero of Jesus' story. If we're honest with ourselves, we are very often like the priest and the Levite. We compromise all the time. We make excuses for ourselves. We try to be sensible. But in this story, Jesus is saying that we are not to live like other people. He's saying that it's beautiful and radical and costly to be Christian. So this is not a story about ignorant, cruel, insensitive people. It's about people like us. Fine, upstanding, honest people. But Jesus is challenging us. Challenging us to go beyond the law, to go beyond excuses, and to go beyond authority. He's calling on us to choose love, a love that shows itself in compassion and in being good Samaritans to everyone. Now I know there are people gathered here today particularly because they are sick, they are ill, perhaps some of you with chronic illnesses, and some of you feeling that the burden of the years. This story says to you that God will never pass you by. God will never pass you by. And that God is with you, looking after you in the struggles and the sufferings that you are going through. And the other thing this story is saying to you is that there are no Samaritans in your life. Those members of family and friends, those neighbors, those professional carers who are caring for you, they are signs of God's love in your life. They are the good Samaritans in your life. And at this Mass, we give praise and thanks to God for them.